Ezekiel chapter 14. How many of you have ever taken the time to read through the whole Bible from start to finish? Okay, good. How many of you have ever done that in a year? Done it in a year? I'm actually doing that right now. I'm a little ahead of schedule. But I got a reading plan off of Apple's store or whatever. And it's just a straight, three chapters every day. It's exceptions, sometimes four, whatever. And I just go through it, and I just take right from the beginning of the Bible right to the end. Now, there was a time when I got into Leviticus. I know you find this hard to believe, but I got into Leviticus, and I had to skip ahead to read a psalm or two just to give myself something for the day, because getting into Leviticus, sometimes you can get a little thick. It's all good, but sometimes you read through it, and you kind of space out a little bit with it, like we shouldn't. But anyway, I decided to read a psalm. Just so I could walk away with it or something, or read through the genealogies or something. Though, by the way, read through the genealogies, I tell you, it's really quite fascinating. It really is. I've preached on a subject or a specific character in the Bible, and then I'm reading through the genealogies, and there their name is. This week I was studying through, studying for a Sunday school lesson, and I found the town of Shechem. You've heard of Shechem, I'm sure. I'm talking about this in Sunday school, so I'm not going to actually tell you what I learned. But anyway, it's really fascinating to see where Shechem is in the Bible. And there's a whole message in that in and of itself, and sometime I'll have to preach on Shechem. But it's really quite a fascinating thing. But when you start to study the Word of God, things start to, or just read through the Word of God one chapter right after another. It's really quite interesting to see how the Word of God flows. And I challenge you to do that sometime. Just open the Bible and start reading from the very beginning. And I keep track of it, but get a good Bible reading program that you can get that'll help you keep track of it. But anyway, all that to say, I was reading through the book of Ezekiel this week, and I know sometimes Ezekiel is one of those books where you go, what in the world? What in the world? What was the Lord having him do that for? One time in particular, God had him go in the middle of town and build a house and then burrow through the wall of the house to the outside. Take all of his stuff through the hole and put it out in the road, and then go take all the stuff and put it back in the house and fill the hole in again. Right in front of everybody. And you look at that and you go, what in the world? Well, God always has a purpose for all of these things. He didn't do it just to make Ezekiel look stupid. He was trying to get people's attention and teach them a specific principle. Anyway, all that to say, Ezekiel's an interesting book. It really is. But I was reading through it this week, and I came across this passage, and it just struck me. And I just knew this was something that I had to preach about. And so I prepared this message, and then I remembered, we have the fifth Sunday, and so I'm not going to have to preach Sunday night, but I guess I was wrong. So anyway, that's all right. We'll go ahead and look at this tonight. Ezekiel chapter 14, verse number 1. Then came certain of the elders of Israel unto me and sat before me. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, these men have set up their idols in their heart and put the stumbling block of their iniquity before their face. Should I be inquired of at all by them? Therefore speak unto them and say unto them, Thus saith the Lord God, every man of the house of Israel setteth up his idols in his heart, and putteth the stumbling block of his iniquity before his face, and cometh to the prophet, I, the Lord, will answer him that cometh according to the multitude of his idols, that I may take the house of Israel in their own heart, because they are all estranged from me through their idols. Therefore say unto the house of Israel, Thus saith the Lord God, Repent, and turn yourselves from your idols, and turn away your faces from all your abominations. For every one of the house of Israel, or of the stranger that sojourneth in Israel, which separateth himself from me, and setteth up his idols in his heart, and putteth the stumbling block of his iniquity before his face, and cometh to a prophet to inquire of him concerning me, I, the Lord, will answer him by myself. And I will set my face against that man, and will make him a sign and a proverb, and I will cut him off from the midst of my people, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. And if the prophet be deceived when he hath spoken a thing, I, the Lord, have deceived that prophet, and I will stretch out my hand upon him, and will destroy him from the midst of my people Israel. And they shall bear the punishment of their iniquity. The punishment of the prophet shall be even as the punishment of him that seeketh unto him, that the house of Israel may go no more astray from me, neither be polluted any more with all their transgressions, but that they may be my people, and I may be their God, saith the Lord God. This evening, I'd like to speak on eliminating idols in the heart. Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts now in this time. Lord, I pray that you would help me to be able to put aside the distractions of the day. And Lord, I pray that you would help us all to focus on your word this evening. And Lord, I pray that you would do something here tonight that will be memorable, not because of the preacher, but because of what you did. Lord, I pray that you would take this message and use it as a step toward revival in our hearts. And Lord, would you use the message, I pray in Jesus' name, amen. I don't think I have to tell you that we have a problem with idolatry in our country today. We have a problem with idolatry in Christian circles. Now, I'm going to talk about idolatry in just a second, but I believe idolatry, specific idols, but I believe idolatry is when we put anything as more important than the Lord. Now, we could also make it so that an idol could be something that we know is not right, but we continue to do it anyway, simply because we want to do it. See, that then becomes more important than God. Or, as the Bible says in Exodus chapter 20, thou shalt not make any graven image or any likeness of anything. Again, that's a reference to idolatry. And I believe we as Christians can also put up an idol in our life that is making God to be something that he's not. In other words, does God wink at sin? And the answer to that is no. Is God okay with worldliness? And the answer to that is no. So if we say that God is, then we have made a likeness of God that isn't accurate. And you know what, friends? That's idolatry. It is. And I'm afraid we do that more often than we actually want to admit. We really do. I myself included. But here in this passage, some elders, leaders of Israel, come to Ezekiel and they come to speak to him. Now, they weren't very good guys, but they were coming probably for the purpose of tripping him up or to get him to say something that perhaps could get him into trouble. Well, the Lord saw that coming a mile away, and so he informed Ezekiel, isn't it always a good thing to have God on your side? It really is. And here Ezekiel has the Lord on his side, and he says, Ezekiel, don't be fooled by these guys. They have idols in their heart. Now, could Ezekiel see the idols that they were worshiping? No. But he knew they were there. Why? Because God told him. So these men came and they had idols in their heart, and they wanted to ask of the Lord something in particular to probably mess Ezekiel up in some way. But God warned him and cut them off at the pass, if you will. Tonight I want to talk about several things in regard to idolatry, but specifically this matter of eliminating idols in the heart. Do you have any idols in your heart? Well, let's look at it tonight. Number one, let's see the different kinds of idols. There's all kinds of idols mentioned in Scripture, but they do give us, I believe, parallels and also just specific things that we have struggles with as idols in our lives today. Let's first of all talk about real idols. I mean, physical idols, idols that we can see. Do we have any of those around the world today? Is there idolatry anywhere in the world today? Well, absolutely. If you go places, you don't even have to go very far. You can go right into the neighborhood across the street and you can find some idols in people's yards. You really can. I'm talking about statues and things like that. You see them in people's homes. I've been in people's homes, and so have you, where they have statues of certain people that they have, and they worship them. I've been in specific places where people have occultic things for worship. I remember when I was in Cambodia, it wasn't uncommon to go to people's houses and find occultic paraphernalia and stuff like that on a shelf. And these people would come and they would have incense there and they would go and they would light it and they would worship there at that idol. Buddhists, Hindus, Catholics, Mormons. See, all these people, they have idols. They do. They don't want to admit it, but they do. And they worship them many times. They see a specific statue or something and they bow down to it. Maybe they don't bow down. Maybe they cross themselves or something like that. You know, what they're doing is worshiping an idol. People's homes. We find them in people's homes. We find them in churches today. Somebody once said this, just recently here, as a matter of fact, I think in the last couple of weeks, he said this: we have to empty ourselves of the many small or great idols that we have and in which we take refuge, on which we often seek to base our security. That's a pretty good statement. But who do you think made that statement? Pope Francis. The Pope said that. Now, if there's any place that has idols, in fact, if you go to different, I'm not trying to just pick on Catholics here, so don't get me wrong. There's other problems in religions in the world. But if you go to certain Catholic churches around the world, you'll find idols all over the place. One place in particular over in England, there is a Catholic church that actually has, this is exciting. They actually have a pickled head of one of their saints. One of their martyrs. His name is Sir Oliver Plunkett. How would you like a name like that? Sir Oliver Plunkett. But he was the last Catholic martyr in England, I guess it is. And they took his head and they put it inside of a case, formaldehyde or something like that, and his head still sits there and people come by and they worship it. As one of our, you know, as one of the saints, you know. In Quebec City, when I was there, actually it wasn't Quebec, it was in the town that we were at, but there's a great big cathedral there, St. Anne's Basilica, and there is supposedly, St. Anne was the mother of Jesus, supposedly, or mother of Mary, mother of Mary, grandmother of Jesus, and there is a bone that they have on display, and it's a femur bone or something like this, and they have it encased in a case where nobody can get to it. And people come by, they offer prayers, they sit and they pray to the bone of Anne. You know what that is? That's idolatry. There was a place, I heard about this. I'm not sure exactly where it was, but they had a the foot bone, I think it was the foot bone, of another saint on display there, and people would come by and they would actually kiss it and they would pray and offer sacrifices to it, and a man that was standing there in charge noticed as some lady walked away that there was a bone missing, and he said, hey lady, hold on just a second, come back here, and he could tell that she had something in her mouth. She had taken the bone, put it in her mouth, and had tried to steal it and walk away. Listen, friends, I'm sorry, but that is, number one, disgusting. But also, number two, that's the epitome of idolatry. You know, if you go to the country of India, you will find idols everywhere. They say that the country of India has 300 million different gods. And it's true, you find all sorts of weird things on display, things with multiple arms and heads, and it's just everywhere. You'll be walking along and there's an idol, and you walk along again, there's another idol, and they're all different. They all have their specific thing that they're supposed to do, but it's idolatry. Buddhist temples have some of the biggest statues in the world that people come and worship. In fact, one of the biggest, statue of a religious leader that people come and worship is in a Buddhist temple, and it's like 450 feet high or something like that. Just huge. But many other churches around the world have them as well. That's just a couple of examples. So we find them in people's homes. We find them in churches. We find them in communities. Certain places around the world have communities with certain statues and figures placed all over the place. They're idolatrous in nature. You also can go to just random places out in the middle of nowhere and you'll find a statue. Garrett Conley told a story to the kids about a man that he knows, a professor of college there, an ambassador, and he was a missionary in Korea for years. And he was going to a certain village, and on the way there was just this great big statue in the middle of the path on the side of a mountain. And he looked one way, and he looked another way, and he just kind of went and pushed it off the side of the mountain, and it broke into pieces. Not exactly a great way to start a relationship with a village, but anyway, that's what he did. He didn't get in trouble for it, but they were pretty mad that somebody had broken their idol. But anyway, you find them in different places just out in the middle of nowhere. See, the point is we find physical idols everywhere, but we also find spiritual idols, spiritual idolatry. To understand what we're talking about, let us take the common idols that we find in Scripture and give them a modern-day comparison, if you will. What were some of the physical idols that we found in Scripture in the Old Testament? Can anybody just throw out some names here? Okay, the golden calf. There's a lot of them. Yes, Tom, there were a lot of them, but looking for specific names. Baal, okay, that was one of them. Ashtaroth. What was another one? What was it? Molech. Okay, yes. Dagon. In the New Testament, you had Diana, Princess Diana. There was a, not Princess Diana, but a statue of Diana there. Sorry. I was just reading a story, a news story, about how the Queen of England is going to be the longest serving queen ever next month. But anyway, and Princess Diana was mentioned there. But anyway, the goddess Diana, excuse me. Okay, well, there were several different idols, lots of idols talked about in Scripture. The children of Israel got involved in all of them. But let me talk about them here for just a second. First of all, you have the gods of sensuality. Baal was an idol of sensuality. Oftentimes, immoral acts would accompany the idol worship of Baal in the temples. In fact, an example of that would be Samuel's sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Ashtaroth, Dagon, Rimmon, Tammuz, Ammon, Succoth, Merodach, Diana. These were all gods that accompanied sensuality in the Bible. So taking that comparison, they were gods of sensuality. Do we have any gods of sensuality in our lives? Could we conceivably have some? Well, of course we could. Sensuality is the idea of just pleasure, things, pleasing the flesh. Do we ever please our flesh instead of please the Lord? Well, whenever we do that, we put up an idol. You know, I think Christians today, myself included, are guilty of worshiping at the idols of sensuality all the time. We need to be careful. We look at our lives and see what it is that we are living for, the things that we are trying to do, where we are living sensual, flesh-pleasing. The second kind is the gods of child sacrifice. Think about this. Molech, Adramelech, and occasionally Baal. Sometimes these idols were used for child sacrifice. The idea of them passing their children through the fire. Think about this. Sometimes even feeding them to the flames. Awful. We think about how sick and perverted and twisted that is, all so that they can hopefully please their God that doesn't even exist, that can't do a thing for them. The gods of child sacrifice. Sometimes we as people today live without thinking about our children, don't we? We don't think about the consequences that could happen as a result of living with the gods of child sacrifice. You know, Jacob did this when he went to Shechem. He was supposed to continue on to Bethel, but he stopped and he built himself a house. And as a result of that, his daughter got herself into trouble with the men there of Shechem. One man in particular. And then, of course, Jacob's sons went in and killed all of the men of the village. It was terrible, an awful situation, but it was because Jacob decided he was going to do something that he found himself out of God's will. It was the God of child sacrifice. You know, many times we teach our children by example. Do you want your kids to struggle with the same sins and problems that you struggle with? I don't. I sure don't. And I think all of us, if we're right in our minds, would say, I don't want my kids to have the same problems I have, the same weaknesses and things like that. I sure hope my children don't have that. I sure don't want my kids to have to deal with that. But you know, many times we could just care less about what happens to our kids. We don't think about, I mean, we do to some degree, but we don't think about their ultimate goal and what happens. And as a result, we just go ahead and engage in the activities we normally engage in, and because we like it or whatever, and we're not thinking about the consequences that it can have on our kids. We listen to the whatever kind of music that we wanted to because that's what we listened to back when we were a kid and a teenager or whatever, and we love it. We're not really thinking about what could happen, the impact it could have on our kids. We watch whatever we want to watch on TV, not thinking about the consequences that it could have on our kids and the stuff and the garbage that they're putting into their brains. We take them places where they're exposed to stuff that could damage them, their minds and their hearts. I'm not saying we intentionally do this, but I'm afraid many times we do things like that simply because we want to do it, and we don't think about the consequences that it could have with our kids. We need to be careful about the gods of child sacrifice. The third kind of god that you found there was the gods of Satan worship. You find this all the time. Serum, goat worship, soothsayers, diviners, necromancers. It's a big word for somebody that calls up the dead. Wizards, witchcraft. These are all forms of Satan worship. And while we as Christians may say, you know what, we're not going to be involved or worship things that are in the occult. We're not going to do that. We sure can through other means. Like what, for instance? You ever heard the verse for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry? You know what, friends? If we are so intent on doing our own things and rebelling against God of heaven and sinning the way that we want to do, in other words, really worshiping and trying to go along with the devil. And we may not bow down to him and worship him, but if we're living in rebellion, it's as bad as worshiping Satan. It really is. We really see how serious this idolatry can be. It's a big deal. So our rebellion then can be idolatry. It can. I say, oh, that's not a big deal, but it can be a rebellion. It can be idolatry in your heart. It really can. So the gods of Satan worship, and then the gods of self. This kind of goes along with the gods of sensuality, but the gods of self, the idea of just living for myself. We see the examples of idol worship where God's people bow down to a specific person. Nebuchadnezzar is an example of that. You say, oh, that was the kingdom of Babylon. How many men were there that did not bow down to King Nebuchadnezzar? Three men that we have a record of, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And what happened to them? They're cast into the fiery furnace. Do you think there were any other children of Israel present when they had that ceremony where everybody bowed down to that idol that was supposed to represent King Nebuchadnezzar? Oh yeah, you better believe it. There were people from all over the world, and that included the nation of Israel. I believe there were many of God's people there present, and they went ahead and bowed down just like everybody else did. See, they were willing to please a person rather than please God. When we don't do right and we rebel and desire to please ourselves, we are also ultimately worshiping ourselves and not God. God wants us to obey Him, but oftentimes we simply obey ourselves. We can't worship self and expect God's blessing. We can't go through life and say, you know, what is it that I want to do? You can't do that. You have to go through life and say, God, what is it that you want me to do? And then do it. This is most definitely an idol that is placed in the heart. In other words, we try to worship and do things our own way. Do you remember King Hezekiah? King Hezekiah was the one who was a good king for a while, and then he decided that he was going to worship his own way. And he felt like he should be, since he was the king, since he was the most important man in the kingdom, he felt like he should be able to go into the temple and worship just like all the priests were doing. And so he went and took his censer, and he decided he was going to go ahead and do his worship. And while he was in there, the Bible says that the leprosy rose up in his body, and you could see it. And the priest had to shove him out, literally force him out of the temple. You know what Hezekiah's problem was? Himself. He thought he was too important to worship God's way, and so he just went ahead and worshiped himself. How often do we do that in our lives? The Bible tells us that if we sin, probably the greatest deception that there is deceiving our own selves. If we are doers of the word and not hearers only, or we're hearers of the word and not doers only, we deceive ourselves. And that's the greatest deception that there really is. Because if you deceive yourself, you can't see that you're wrong. And you can't change anything. So the gods of self, and these are really the four kinds of idolatry that you find throughout Scripture. But I want you to see, secondly, here the problems with idolatry. Problems with idolatry. Verse number 3 says, Son of man, these men have set up their eyes in their heart and put the stumbling block of their iniquity before their face. Should I be inquired of it all by them? First of all, it's a stumbling block of iniquity. Idolatry is something that is set up that will trip us up. You know, the idea of, you find in the book of Hebrews, you find the idea of the sin which doth so easily beset us. You know what that is? That's a sin that is put in our path that will trip us up. But the interesting thing about that phrase is that it's a stumbling block that we put in our own path. It's a sin that easily besets us because we put it there. And you know what? That's what idolatry does. Idolatry puts up a stumbling block of iniquity. And who puts it there? Does God put it there? Of course not. We put it there ourselves. So in other words, we set it there and then we trip over it. Now you say, that's kind of crazy. Why would people do that? Have you ever done that? Have you ever done that physically? You put something in the middle of the floor and then you forget it's there and you trip over it? Oh, come on. Don't give me that look like, oh, I've never done that before. Of course you have. I've done it before. That's just the way we are as humans. We forget. But you know, that's what we do spiritually. We put a stumbling block in our own path. We set something up. It's as if we're setting the idol up right in front of us. And then as we're walking along in our path, we trip over it. It's a stumbling block of iniquity. And we get ourselves in trouble. Well, how? First of all, we get ourselves in trouble spiritually. See, when we have a loose view of God and say that He winks at sin and is okay with that, that's idolatry and it's a stumbling block. It can trip us up and we can fall into the mud of life, the mud of sin. Do you ever get upset when people rebuke you or correct you for doing something wrong? If you do, you know what you've entered into? Idolatry. Idolatry. Why? Because we're getting tripped up by something that we enjoy, something that we like, something that we perhaps thought was a good idea. Okay, so I'm going to get mad at somebody. And then somebody comes along and says, you probably shouldn't get mad at that person. Well, you know what? If you get mad back at the other person, you know what you're doing? You're getting yourself all in trouble. Spiritually, you're putting a stumbling block in front of yourself. But also physically, you know, idols can have a bad effect on us physically as well. See, when we're pleasing our flesh, it will affect us physically. Have you ever been guilty about something and you sat and stressed out about it? Did you know guilt causes stress? You know, I've seen people actually hurt themselves physically because of bitterness in their heart. Do you know bitterness is an idol? I've seen people destroy their lives because of bitterness. They put that idol of bitterness up in their heart, and physically they're affected. Everything about them. Their blood pressure goes up. Their mood changes. They're upset at everybody because of bitterness. So physically, you know, that guilt can many times bring on physical ailments because stress does the same thing. You could say something that can get you into trouble. You can do things that you know aren't right simply because you have put up a stumbling block in your life. So that's the first problem with idolatry. But secondly, verse number 3 goes on. And it says, put the stumbling block of your iniquity before their face. Should I be inquired of at all by them? The second problem here is that God won't hear us. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Notice how God refers to idolatry throughout the rest of the passage. It says that we are estranged from God. Now that's kind of a weird way to put it, but it's as if we are pushed away. We're estranged from God. He doesn't know us. It says that we are engaged in abominations. That's kind of shocking. That's pretty straightforward. Verse number 6. And turn away your faces from all your abominations. So my idols that I have in my heart are abominations? Yes. Verse number 7 says, which separateth himself from me. We separate ourselves from God. We do. The first one was that we are estranged from God, which means that God says that there's something different about us. He puts us at arm's length. But then when we do so, when we are engaged in idols, we are also separating ourselves from God. We're also pulling back. But then it also goes on to say that we will be polluted. Number 11, verse 11, that the house of Israel may go no more astray from me, neither be polluted anymore with all their transgressions. Does it sound to you like idolatry is a problem? It really is. Because God won't hear us. God won't hear us. Do you like to engage in conversations with people that don't smell very good? I'm not trying to be unkind here, but have you ever had that experience? What was your goal? To finish the conversation as quick as possible. Now again, I'm not trying to be unkind here, but that's the way God looks at us. We're polluted. He wants to put us at arm's length and say, get away from us. Why? Because of our sin, because of our idolatry. In fact, we're an abomination. We're an abomination. We make God sick because of our idolatry. So how you doing? God won't hear us. Verse number 7. We separate ourselves from God. I've already mentioned this. Let me take it a little bit more here. By having idols in our heart, we are intentionally separating ourselves from the Lord. We're intentionally severing our relationship with Him. This is a step that we take on our own. God won't hear us, and He refers in negative terms to our idolatry, but we also step away. God wants us drawing nigh to Him, not going the other direction. James chapter 4. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. You know what double-mindedness is? It's idolatry. I'm serving two people. I'm serving God, and I'm also serving whatever else it is. We have separated ourselves from God. In fact, you could go a step further and say that we have become God's enemy. James chapter 4, again, verse 4. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, don't ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore is a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Well, that's pretty serious. So our separation from the Lord through our idolatry actually makes it so that we're fighting for the enemy. We're fighting for the other side. You see how big of a deal idolatry is? But also, verse number 8 tells us that we will ruin our lives. And I will set my face against that man and will make him a sign and a proverb, and I will cut him off from the midst of my people, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. We will become the Lord's enemy. You could look at it this way. If you could look at it this way in the form of a question. Do you want to become a sermon illustration? Now again, that may be a kind of a weird way to put it. But you know, that's what he's saying here. Down there in verse number 9, and the prophet be deceived. I'm sorry, that's not it. Verse number 8 again. I will make him a sign and a proverb. In other words, people will talk about you. They'll make an application based upon your life because of your idolatry. That's serious. Idolatry will ruin our lives. It really will. The reason is because we need God to survive. Not just spiritually, but physically, emotionally, mentally, in every way. We have to have God. And if we are serving idols and worshiping other idols, you know what we're doing? We're separating ourselves from the Lord. And our lives have become double-minded. We have become two-faced. We have been serving two masters. And the Bible says it's impossible to do that. You can't please the Lord when you do so. And we'll ruin our lives. Do you see how big of a deal idolatry is? So then, what's the solution to heart idolatry? Are you sitting out there wondering if there's something that God is dealing with you about in particular? Maybe God's pointed at something in your life. He says, this is an idol. Maybe it's your favorite television show. Maybe it's that place that you love to go. Maybe it's the music that you love to listen to. Maybe it's the way that you're talking to people. I don't know, you name it. Maybe it's the games that you play. But something has become an idol in your life, something that's far more important than the Lord, or takes the place of God in some way or another. Maybe it's sleep. Maybe instead of getting up in the morning and reading your Bible every day, or doing it before you go to bed at night, you sleep instead. Sleep can be an idol. Maybe your work is an idol. I don't know. Whatever it is, you know. What's the solution then to idolatry? Look at verse number 6. Therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord God, repent and turn yourselves from your idols and turn away your faces from all your abominations. First of all, God says to repent. In other words, turn around and go the other direction. This is the idea of taking heart action. I am changing my heart. I'm changing my mind. You repent and get forgiveness for whatever it is that has become an idol or idols. We must say what God says about it. Heart idolatry needs to be admitted in the heart and gotten right. Right now. It really does. So God says, first of all, to repent. Secondly, God says to turn from your idols. In other words, turn around physically and go the other direction. This is the idea of taking physical action. If there's something that you know is a problem in your life, then you need to get rid of it. You're taking action. So in other words, that television program you know is a problem. You turn off the television. That kind of music that you're listening to, you know isn't right. You turn it off and you get rid of it. Those magazines or whatever it is that has become an idol is more important than God and what God says, you get rid of it. You take physical action. You have a problem with your tongue in your anger. You get rid of it. Now, you don't get rid of your tongue, okay? You don't get rid of your anger and all that, but you get rid of your anger, but you do it with the Lord's help, obviously. Whatever has become an idol, you need to eliminate it. You need to take action. Take action immediately. You repent of it. You say, God, forgive me. This is something that's been a problem. Lord, forgive me. Please, I don't want it anymore. I'm turning my back on it. And then whatever it is that's a problem, you need to eliminate it. Get rid of it. Because many times the things on the outside encourage and feed the idolatry on the inside. So God says to turn from our idols, like our TV, our books, our music, our conversations, whatever it is. And then we need to turn back to the Word of God. Throughout this passage of Scripture, we see again and again and again, thus saith the Lord, thus saith the Lord, thus saith the Lord. We return back to the Word of God. Verse number 6, therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord, repent and turn yourselves from your idols and turn away your faces from all your abomination. Thus saith the Lord. We need to get back to the Word of God. And we need to get back to putting God on the throne of the life and serving Him and loving Him exclusively. What do we do to show God that we love Him? Give ourselves for it. Everything that we do for God. We do it with His help and with His strength. We walk in dependence upon God. The message is pretty simple. Do you have idolatry in your life? You may not have set up physical idols in your home, but you could have set up something that's a spiritual idol in your heart. You know, we won't see revival in our church, we won't see revival in our country until Christians decide that they need to get rid of the idols in their lives. What is it that's an idol in your life that God is speaking to you specifically about tonight? Will you repent? Will you turn away from it? Get it out of your life? And turn back to God and serve Him wholeheartedly with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That's the key. Lord, help us